You have entered as an organizer and may now speak to any other organizers or panelists on the line. When you are ready to begin the presentation, press the Start Broadcast button on the GoToWebinar control panel to allow all attendees to hear you. This system will notify you once you begin your broadcast. The broadcast is now starting. All attendees are in listen-only mode.
Hello? Hello?
Hello? Hello, Dr. Shaila has done his MBBS and MS from Digman. He is SAMS, BMKS, certificate in Da Vinci Robotic Surgical System. He is Associate Professor, Department of Obstetrics and Gynecology, MES Medical College, Pelithan, Manna, Kerala. He is Consultant Laparoscopic Surgeon, MES Medical College, Pelithan, Manna, LEO Hospital, Kalpeta, Vyanar, and Ramdas Nursing Home, Pelithan, Ramannam, and Surya Hospital, Thirur. Now he will give a talk on his Shaila's technique of cesarean section.
Hello?
Oh, fine.
Okay. One second. Can you speak now?
I have shared the screen.
Yeah, okay, thanks.
Hello?
Dada?
I have shared the...
Yeah, just a minute. Yeah, connect. Just a minute, Dr. Shaiva. Okay. So now you can begin your talk, Dr. Shaiva.
Hello?
Just a minute.
Yeah. Hello?
Yeah, Dr. Shaiza, just a minute. You're just connecting.
Are you able to see my slides?
Yeah, we can see your slides, but your voice is not heard. Just a minute.
Hello?
Dr. Shaizes?
Yeah, I can hear you. Can you hear me now?
You can hear me?
Yeah.
Just a minute, we have some technical problem here. We are just sorting it out and then we'll connect. But you keep keep your slides on.
Yeah, my slides are on my system.
Yeah,
इसके बाद मेरा है
माइक तो है इसको
नहीं मैं आपका लैपटॉप बंद कर
देंगे Should I click my webcam?
Yeah, your webcam is on and we can see your slides. Only thing is your voice is not heard and we are arranging for that.
Okay, fine, fine.
Dr. Shizus?
Yeah.
Yes.
Can you...
Now you can proceed with your talk.
Okay. I hope the audio part is clear now.
बड़ा? थोड़ी उठा.
Am I audible there?
थोड़ी सी कम कर.
Yes.
Yeah. Can I start now?
Just a minute. The sound is the okay, volume is being controlled. Just speak out something.
Okay.
थोड़ा सा और कम.
मैं रूम में कम.
Are you able to hear me now?
Yeah. Just a minute, I'll let you know as soon as the volume is proper, I'll ask you to start the presentation.
Oh, sure.
It's okay. So yes, now you can start your presentation, Dr. Shizus. Thank you.
Okay, fine. Yeah. Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. It's a pleasure to be a part of Spectrum 2016, a place where we learn through webinars. Makes it very convenient for people like us who don't have to travel all the way to meet and exchange these kind of things. Today, we're going to talk about naturalizing a cesarean section. Cesarean section is a very, very common surgery that we do in our obstetric practice. And over the next 15 to 20 minutes, we are attempting to naturalize this common surgery that is done in our obstetric practice. I'm sure all of you would agree with me that women these days suffer from an epidemic known as cesarean, isn't it? And we have reached a stage where the obstetrician is seen as someone who threatens her ability to have a natural childbirth. Jokes apart, we do understand for known or unknown reasons, cesarean section rates are on the rise, and we have reached a stage where almost 50% or even more is being in a manner. Now, after having performed the surgery for years together, the big question that we really need to ask ourselves is, have you really mastered the surgery? And the answer, which I generally get from even some of the most experienced obstetricians of the country, is a big no. There have always been a few who have asked me, what can be new with a cesarean section? A surgery where we open the uterus, take the baby out and close it. I'm sure all of you have assembled here would agree with me that it is not as simple as that. Now, why do we actually require an improvisation in a cesarean? Primarily because satisfaction rates after a cesarean section are very poor. If you look at the evidence worldwide, you would find that satisfaction rates after a cesarean are even poorer when compared to some of the most complicated surgeries that we do in our routine practice, something like a radical hysterectomy for a poor satisfaction rates have been attributed to the intraoperative and the postoperative morbidity and mortality that is related to a cesarean section. The other important reason why an improvisation is needed is because difficulties during a cesarean is still quite a common problem. Even now I get calls at the middle of the night with people having difficulty with baby delivery, with placental delivery, dealing with an atonic postpartum uterus, and I think it would be the same with many of you too. We understand that cesarean section itself is a risk factor for atonicity. If you look at the current available evidence, you would get to know that there's an 8 to 10 fold increased risk of encountering an atonic postpartum uterus at a cesarean section when compared to a normal vaginal delivery. It's very commonly attributed to the absence of uterine activity and a very rapid evacuation of intrauterine contents, which generally happens when you attempt to pull out the baby at a cesarean. Now, from my early postgraduate days, I always thought emulate the principles of a normal vaginal delivery at a cesarean section. That has finally led to this particular technique of doing a cesarean section. Opening the abdomen is basically the same. What I do differently is immediately after placing the patient in dorsal position, after giving a regional anesthesia, I start a pre-incision oxytocin infusion. It is 5 international units of oxytocin in 500 ml solution and started at 32 drops per minute. I repeat, 5 units of international units of oxytocin in 500 ml of solution started at 32 drops per minute equates to around 20 milli international units per minute. I always ensure the presence of uterine contractions before I make the uterine incision. Generally, it takes around 2 to 3 minutes for the uterine contractions to be in place, which is your cleaning and draping time. Needless to say that uterine weight, depending upon your baby size assessment, I use a technique called the slide maneuver to deliver the fetal head. Principle-wise, it's similar to the single blade rectus application of forceps at a cesarean section to facilitate baby delivery. But here, there's no instrument. The instrument is your own hand. To lift up the baby towards the uterine incision from its direction towards the pelvis with the tip of your index and middle finger of your dominant hand. And what you do is to provide it a surface to slide on, which is provided by the palmar aspect of your middle and index finger. Now, with only the head outside the uterine cavity, I do the initial neonatal dissipation on table. What I do next is to just support the baby at the level of the neck or the shoulders, allow the uterus to contract and expel the baby by itself. Thereby, I achieve a near total spontaneous delivery of the baby at a cesarean section. You need to note that there is no fundal pressure, there's neither a pulling of the baby from below. What we do next is to do ceremonious cord clamping. And by the time you get back to the incision site, you have an already separated placenta presenting at the uterine incision without any squeezing efforts, without putting your whole hand into the placenta, which is already separated, just come out very easily. You need to carry on with your routine uterine, rectus and skin lotion as you would do the conventional cesarean. You can watch the video. This is the slide maneuver to lift up the baby towards the uterine incision, allowing it to surface to slide on. Now, with only the head outside the uterine cavity, you will do the initial neonatal resuscitation. But according to the recent age, you need not really do this. Risk of stimulating the vagus when you stimulate the palate, thereby causing bradycardia. So you can apply these principles accordingly. Only if it's required, you need to do the resuscitation. What I do next is to just support the baby at the level of the neck or the shoulders and allow the uterus to contract and expel the baby by itself. You can carefully put the uterus upon the baby's chest, squeezing out the lung fluid through the nasal and the oral orifices of the baby. No manipulations of the baby. It is the uterus which would act and expel the baby by itself, thereby achieving the near total spontaneous delivery of the baby at a cesarean section. I hope you appreciate that. We carry on with the the Atlantic while having the rest of the DNA in the situation. As for the recent least amount of oronasal suction needed if the baby is otherwise active. I generally take the pleasure of handing over the baby to the assistant who is already waiting. And by the time you get back to the incision site, you have a very happy thing to see. A placenta which is already separated and showing at the uterine incision. Without any squeezing of the uterus, without putting a hand into the uterine cavity, you just have to remove an already separated placenta as effortlessly as you're watching. Quite effortless, isn't it? I also want you to appreciate the non-bleeding uterine edges because you are working on the concept of living ligature here. So there's hardly any bleeding from the uterine edges, if you can note here. Fine. This one, this is the fifth cesarean after previous four cesareans. Generally, people encounter a lot of difficulties, but we will see how we can nullify all that by using this technique and making the uterus contract. You can appreciate the slide maneuver much better in this video with more clarity. Put your hand inside, lift the baby towards a uterine incision with the tip of your index and middle finger of your dominant hand. Give it the direction and then give it a surface to slide on with the palmar aspect of your index and middle finger. The uterus would contract and help you in delivering the head too. You just have to give it a direction. Now with only the head outside, you can see an active baby. Controlled amount of oronasal suction, as would be suggested. I hope you appreciate how happily the baby is moving around. Something like a turtle sign, but there's no shoulder. Okay. What I do next is to just release the anterior shoulder there with the least amount of effort. Support the baby at the level of the neck or the shoulders. Allow the uterus to contract and expel the baby by itself. You would see that the baby would almost kick the uterus back on its way. It's otherwise known as the baby's walkout technique. See the active baby not being disturbed by a frontal pressure, not being disturbed by a pull, but a baby being given the time to be expelled by the contracting uterus. At this point, also want to appreciate the already separated placenta, which is presenting right here at the uterine incision. Are you able to see that? Fine. Post-cesarean pregnancies, twin gestations, and both babies in breech presentation. Generally, people have a lot of difficulties, primarily because of the post-cesarean pregnancy with two babies, both in breech presentation. Let's see how we can tackle the breech with this technique using uterine contractions. Again here, the idea would be to reduce the manipulation on the breech to the least minimum and appreciate the beauty of a breech delivery. We hardly get to see all these movements these days because vaginal breech delivery is hardly done. Only thing you have to do here is to put your fingers at the groin and give the breech a direction so that uterus can contract well and expel the baby in the right direction because it's a soft tissue part. So only thing needed is to give a direction to the breech by putting your fingers at the groin. No other manipulative efforts are required. It's an extended breech, very beautifully coming out. See how easily the after coming head came out without any manipulative efforts from above. Second one is also in breech presentation. See the movements, the mechanism of sub-breech delivery, which you fail to appreciate many a times because of these babies. Come out, the most keeping its back anterior by itself. If you want, you can always support by a little bit of traction, primarily direction at the level of the groin. After coming head, just have a look at it, how easily, because it's in a flex position because of the contractions of the uterus, so it would not have a tendency to get extended as easily as that. Appreciate that? I don't mind a huge round of applause. Just kidding.
Yes, we appreciate it. Yes. We appreciate it. Actually,
thank you.
The audience clap. You are not able to hear, I think. Let's give a clap. So how did you get the applaud?
Thank you. I was just kidding.
Are you able to hear the applaud?
Yeah, I can very well hear it now.
Thank you. And Dr.
Shaila, thank you so much.
After you finish your slide presentation, I would request you to on your webcam so that the audience will see who is Dr. Shaila Nair.
Oh, fine. Sure. Definitely. Now, carrying on, we would always love to know what are the maternal benefits of doing something like this. So, it's not something which just looks good, but it has got some potential benefits in the form of an effortless and a near total spontaneous baby delivery at a cesarean section, which you would very comfortably agree. Complete avoidance of fundal pressure, no manipulations, no anesthetist pushing the baby out, no sister putting their legs on either side of the patient's abdomen and pushing the baby out for you. None of those dramatic events would happen. Ensures a very easy and a complete removal of the placenta, because you're dealing with a placenta which is already separated. You just have to remove it rather than separating and taking it out. It does reduce the blood loss at the cesarean section because you're primarily working on the concept of, and hence that would explain. It avoids trauma at the cesarean section because you're being least manipulative. Avoids postpartum uterine atonicity because it is the uterus which contracts first and delivers the baby for you. So there's no question of uterus not having tonicity enough to control bleeding in the form of postpartum hemorrhage. Because you're being least manipulative, it does reduce the postoperative pelvic and the abdominal discomfort for the mother. No fundal pressure, so no need to see the level whether fundal pressure is being covered by the spinal anesthesia. And thus, it has been shown to reduce the postoperative analgesic requirements. What are the benefits for the little one? I'm sure all of you would agree that respiratory problems are very common after a cesarean section, primarily because of retained lung fluid and the lack of catecholamine and cortisol surge, which helps in reabsorption of this lung fluid and which is what happens in a normal vaginal delivery. That's why babies which are born by the vaginal route hardly ever reaches the nursery when compared to a cesarean section. One of the important indicators of admission in an ICU is transient tachypnea of newborn, which is primarily attributed to the retained lung fluid. What we are attempting to do here is to achieve physiological autoresuscitation, whereby the contracting uterus would hug upon the baby's chest and would squeeze out the lung fluid through the oral and the nasal orifices and would clear the lung fluid in a much better manner than what you would achieve with your oronasal suction. So use this and follow the AAP guidelines of not doing an oronasal suction for an otherwise active baby, then you are much more likely to end up with a baby which will not reach the nursery. The other important aspect would be the thermal adjustment. I'm sure all of you would agree that the temperature in the theater is much less when compared to the temperature in the intrauterine environment. So if you give the baby those few extra seconds or minutes, the baby's cardiorespiratory performance is going to be much better after birth, because this has been dealt with well. Fine. You will find a lot of evidence for what I have mentioned over the last few slides if you look at these from the literature. If numbers can speak better, I myself would have done somewhere close to 3,000 cesareans performed with this technique, and probably a much bigger number performed by people all around the world. The almost 14 countries in which in one or the other center people are using this technique to tackle their problems related to baby delivery, tackle their problems related to placental delivery, and tackling their problems related to dealing with an atonic postpartum uterus. Unfortunately, we ended up in the prestigious British Journal of Obstetrics and Gynecology with our case series of the first 300 cases, and it was aptly titled Whether We Can Achieve the Benefits of Vaginal Delivery at a Cesarean Section. Got published in the year 2014 in April. And these are the numbers which we published. You look at it, you find that though there were a lot of post-cesarean pregnancies in this case series, because you're starting oxytocin on a post-cesarean pregnancy, because 2 to 3 minutes, nothing goes wrong. No angle extensions because you're being least manipulative. And I'm sure that none of you would expect angular extension to happen when delivery is so smooth. Atonicity happened only in one out of 300 elective cesareans, which is quite good considering the fact that you're dealing with a uterus which otherwise not acting, isn't it? Okay, manual removal of placenta only in one, rest of it, it was as smooth as what you saw in the video. Post-operative pain score is very important. Because of all the manipulative efforts that happens around the routine conventional cesarean, studies have shown that almost 70% of women would have a pain score of 6 or more. And you compare it with this technique, you'll find that the median score is somewhere around 3, which is what majority of patients had. So you're finding a patient who's much more comfortable in the post-operative period. Transient tachycardia of newborn was nil, primary retained lung without coronary suction. 4 NICU admissions were because of morbidity related factors prior to performing a cesarean section. Just like any other new concept, this technique also had its challenges. There's always a general disposition amongst the anesthetist against a pre-incision oxytocin usage, but you need to convince them the fact that the dosage that you're using here is not a routine postpartum hemorrhage therapeutic dose. This is the dose that we very commonly use to induce or augment contractions in labor, so it will hardly ever cause any hemodynamic impairments. They also worry about post-spinal hypotension, but you need to convince them the fact that if you give around 500 ml to 1 liter of fluids, you can totally avoid having the issue of post-spinal hypotension. And you also tell your anesthetist that if you give this, you don't have to push out the baby. Many a times, though jovially said, the most tired person in an operating room after a cesarean section is not the patient who has been in labor and who has been sectioned. The anesthetist with that much of effort in pushing out the baby for you, isn't it? So that can be avoided. So that's a very appealing concept for the anesthetist, this particular technique. Many have come and told me that I am very fresh after cesarean, being an anesthetist now, after, because oxytocin does the job which I was doing before. How to overcome these challenges? The beauty of a normal delivery lies in the concept of living ligature. This technique primarily uses that to control the uterine bleeding as well as to deliver the baby. Hence, it's a physiologically acceptable technique. Many obstetricians around the world are worried about the time that is available to deliver the baby after the uterine incision is made. And that is the primary reason why a cesarean section becomes very dramatic. There is so much of running around and hullagulla that happens around the time of baby delivery, all because people are worried that there's no time. But if you look at evidence, it will tell you that you've got a minimum of 2 to 3 minutes available to deliver the baby from the time of uterine incision to prevent hypoxia and low Apgar's in neonates. And if you use this technique, on second delivery, I generally get a lot of people to watch my cesareans in my theater because they want to see something very different from what they've seen. Everybody calm, cool, in a relaxed manner, watching a baby coming out by itself with the uterus pushing it out. And I always tell them a theory which I very firmly believe in. That is, to be inactive at required times is a masterly act. And what I do best in my technique is to be least manipulative. I'm sure all of you would agree that childbirth is a celebration. No offense intended. I know the lovely, very experienced obstetricians sitting there amongst the audience too. Without any offense intended, many a times because of our worry to deliver the baby and to tackle the difficulties related to cesarean section, we make it look like as if we are having a stunt with the baby. And this is something which we can honestly try to avoid. And I'm sure if you're impressed with all the videos and you would love to go out and try out this technique and feel the difference for yourself, and you're most welcome. And with the hope that I have not taken you to such a state. Are you in such a state? I can't see you now. With the hope that you are not in such a state, thank you so much for being a wonderful audience. It's been a pleasure to be a part of Spectrum 2016.
Dr. Shizes, that was a perfect talk. Did you hear the applaud?
I did hear, but probably I can hear it now. Oh, that! Thank you, thank you, thank you. I hope you are able to see me too.
Is Neha around?
Yeah. She's in the other room.
We could hear her voice in between. She was saying something. Can we see her?
Just a second.
Yes.
Just a second.
Yes. He's an obstetrician and a gynecologist, and he loves to dance. So he could, the another use of webinar is you can see a live dance performance from whoever is interested in giving one. So this is his daughter, Neha. Hello, Neha.
Are you able to see her now?
Thank you so much, Dr. Chaises, for logging in and giving us your time. And that finishes with this panel discussion. Thank you so much. And
thank you so much for the applause.
To the next one.
I would like to thank our chairperson, Dr. Omar Vadwan, and Dr. Rishabh Lakhi. Any questions from the audience? Ma'am, can you ask Dr. Chaises?
Yes, yes. He has it logged out now.
I'm there.
He's there.
Do you have questions? Is he online?
Yes, yes, he is online. Okay, where did he go? Kahan gaya?
Dr. Shaila, are you online?
Yeah. I'm there.
Congratulate you for developing the delivery technique without the help of anesthetists, because we all are habitual of under pressure by anesthetist. But in case of a complete breach, we have to book out the lower limb, book out both the lower limbs.
Okay.
That cannot be done spontaneously. We can't wait for that.
If you're dealing with a flexed breach,
yeah,
either you could get hold of the limbs and bring it out and then deliver the breach with the help of uterine contractions. Now, contractions would start initially itself, which would help to bring the breach down and would keep it almost fixed in the lower uterine segment, which makes it very, very comfortable for you to deliver the breach, rather than a breach which is moving around here and there. So if you can catch hold of the limbs and if you can just bring it out,
yeah,
the contractions would help you in reducing the manipulative efforts on the baby for the rest of the delivery. Is that fine? Now, if you have an extended breach, you have the breach itself in your hold, which you can deliver, as you have very comfortably seen in the video of twins, both in breach presentation. So that would be the way to tackle it. No difficulties at all. For me, there are primarily, if you ask me, there are only two contraindications for starting oxytocin early, immediately after spinal anesthesia. The one would be a second stage or a late first stage cesarean with a very deeply impacted head, where you would want the use till the time you disimpact the baby, and then you would start your oxytocin induced contractions, and then deliver the rest of the baby by itself. Is that fine? Now, the only other contraindication would be a terminal fetal heart rate deceleration seen in cases of massive abduction or probably cord prolapse, where the fetal heart rate has gone for a dip and is unable to pick up by itself. Okay? If it's getting back to normalcy after a deceleration, even then the baby would be able to bear 2 to 3 minutes of contractions without any compromise on the Apgar scores, which is what we have seen throughout the data that we have collected from our series. Okay, so a terminal distress baby where fetal heart rate fails to pick up after deceleration, and number two, a very deeply impacted head, probably in a second stage cephalopelvic disproportion, where you would start your oxytocin only after you disimpact the head, and the rest of the oxytocin induced contractions itself. I hope I am clear.
Whose question was it? Is it clear?
So we also find the difficulties at the time of delivery of shoulder. We have to pull it out at the shoulders. If the baby is big, It cannot come spontaneously.
Which scenario are you talking about? Second stage CPD?
Second stage, at the time, you are saying you wait for spontaneous delivery of the baby, just like vagina delivery, after delivery of the head of the baby.
Waiting is for that much duration of time only, because all the videos that you have seen are real-time videos. So waiting does not mean that you take out the head and you just waiting for a long duration of time. That's not required. Within 2 to 3 minutes, by the time you make the uterine incision itself, contractions are in place. So the only time that is needed after the delivery of the head is, if you want to do an initial oral nasal suction, you can do that with only the head outside. The very next moment, you will hold the baby, support the level of the, support the baby at the level of the neck or the shoulders, allow the uterus to contract and expel the baby. There is no long waiting periods here. And don't even doubt, it's not a slow cesarean. Baby delivery takes around 45 to 60 seconds, that's all. Nothing more than that, which is not too much when compared to the conventional cesareans that you do. And don't really attempt to do a cesarean significantly more faster, because there's always a kind of feeling, especially when you're immediately you've finished your post-graduation and when you're doing your practice, you claim that you've done a cesarean section in 9 minutes, 8, 11 minutes, 12 minutes. But the issue with those kind of cesarean sections where you really pull out the baby and suture the uterus and come out, you would probably spend another 1.5 hours in managing an ectonic postpartum uterus, which is a very likely possibility. Now, we're attempting to avoid all that and make it significantly more convenient as well as more friendly for the mother, the baby, so that uterus would contract. There is no cesarean section related morbidity or mortality that you end up with otherwise. So that is the entire message of this concept.
Thank you, Dr. Shizes, for the perfect presentation and the discussion. The next discussion now and on infertility. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
So we are moving on to another panel discussion on infertility. I would like to invite Dr. Vikram Singh and Dr. Anita Rasu to share the session. Dr. Sabha Azhar, you please join Dr. Anita Rasu. Is not available, and I will announce the list of the other panelists, and we are having Dr. Nisha Bhatnagar as the moderator of this infertility panel discussion, and Dr. Marcus Nishkesh shall be joining us through web. He is from Spain, and Dr. Tini Venugopal, please join the panel discussion. Dr. Mala Saxena from Muradabad. Dr. Anupam Ravi from Rudrapur. Dr. Aditya from Bhubaneswar. Dr. Savana Mehdi. Dr. Manisha Jain. And Mr. A.K. Singh, who is the embryologist at King Khamsa Medical College. Dr. Marcus, can you hear me?
Yes, I can hear you.
I would request you to Switch on your webcam.
See if this is possible.
Yes.
Yes. Can you see me? Hello?
Yes. Welcome, Dr. Marcus. Please introduce yourself and from where you are speaking. So, the place where you are at present.
We'll introduce him.
I'm in Canary Islands in Spain.
Please introduce Dr. Marcus.
Dr. Marcus is a well-known IBM specialist.
He's a pioneer in the field of natural and minimal stimulation IVF, and we are currently lucky to have him at Avea Fertility. He's presently living in Spain, Canary Islands, with his 4 children and his wife. Dr. Marcus, you'll be joining the panelists. The panelists here are Dr. Puneet Rana from Delhi, Dr. Savannah from Delhi, Dr. Sini Venugopal from Bhubaneswar, Dr. Aditya from Bhubaneswar, Dr. Anupama from Haldwani, and Dr. Singh from Muradabad.
Dr. Anita Rasool, please introduce Dr. Nisha Vettanar, our moderator for the panel discussion. Hello. Dr. Nisha Bhatnagar is a senior obstetrician and gynecologist, and she's the IVF specialist in Avea IVF Center. She did the MD and GMC from Aurangabad in 2002. Has interest in the field of infertility, and she is the chief perfect. She persuaded her patients and.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you for the kind introduction. Doesn't matter. First of all, no, it's okay. First of all, I would like to thank the TMU and most important, Asha ma'am, for giving us this panel. And it is really commendable on her part to have this beautiful gathering and this world stage here. Okay, so our discussion is difficulties and dilemmas. I have a beautiful panel. So I think we'll be able to sort all our problems here. First of all, I would like to pose a question to Dr. Savannah. Dr. Savannah, what investigation would you like to do? A patient comes to you for the first time. So what investigation would you like? What treatment options can you give to the patient? And what will be your plan of starting the treatment?
When the patient comes to me for the first time, the most important thing I feel is the proper hysterectomy. Because so many times I find a couple coming to me with infertility, but then when I take a proper history, they have not consummated the marriage or time intercourse has not happened. So first of all, time intercourse. After proper hysterectomy, number one, IUI, IVF, I will not go into detail. Now, about investigations, irrespective of the patient profile, I usually do a good D2 ultrasound for the enteral follicle count and number and quality. And depending on the patient's age, younger age group, I will go ahead with a minimum test of thyroid function I usually do and prolactin I usually do. Okay. And if it is above 35 years, older age group and any previous history of any ovarian surgery, or most important, any history of the premature menopause in the family, then I would go for ovarian reserve tests like day 2, day 3, day 8, AMH, so on. And what is the other question?
Okay, so here I would like to say that only 3, intrauterine, IVF and ICSI, these are the techniques we are offering to the patients. The success rate of the clinic should be told to the patient in the beginning. And even after doing all these techniques, the take-home baby rate is roughly around 20% in the most efficient clinics. Okay, and one more thing I would to clear is that there is no increase in the incidence of congenital anomalies. The most important determinant in the line of action, in the management, is the age of the female patient. Okay, so the whole management changes if a patient comes at 25 and the patient comes at 35. At 25, the cumulative pregnancy rate after 1 year is around 85%. However, the same changes to about 85% in 2 years. So the most important factor is age. And usually the ESHRAE has classified the investigations into 3 parts. I would only mention those who have correlation with pregnancy. And these are the semen analysis, the tubal patency test, and the mid-luteal progesterone to diagnose ovulation. Okay, these 3 tests we should do for any patient who comes to us for further management and planning. These are not related to these things. And these guidelines I have from RCOG. If a patient is having regular cycle, as Dr. Savannah mentioned, that the history taking is very important. Usually there is no problem with the thyroid. I would like to do, because basic thyroid, hypothyroidism, subclinical hypothyroidism sometimes is there. But if the patient is having regular cycles, no menstrual irregularities, I don't think prolactin needs to be done for all the patients.
Okay.
So now next question, Dr. Puneet, please. Now this is a 26-year-old lady. She's married since 3 years. She's having regular cycles. On her day 2 scan, we have 5 to 6 follicles in both the ovaries. Okay. Semen analysis is normal as per WHO standard. Can you please elaborate? How will you go for the management of this patient?
So I would just go with those. I mean, there is some mention of ovarian reserve as documented by 5 to 6 and the follicular count, which is apparently okay, normal. She's got a regular cycle. I think this, the most important thing is the duration. It's a 3-year duration fertility. She's a young woman who's got good reserve, but it's a duration.
Yes.
Something is more complex than this.
Yes.
So the other things, the tumor assessment is not mentioned here.
Yes.
That would be the next thing that we would like to explore. What way should we do it? Whether we should do it HSV or laparoscopy or hysteroscopy? I would go both with lepro and hysteroscopy rather than a simple HSV for tumor assessment.
Dr. Puneet, can you just give us a few words on PCT?
Post-coital test, traditionally, I think, you see historically how it came out because that time we didn't have much advanced technologies and ART techniques. But now we are at a stage where we are more, I would say, technologically savvy. In this particular case, I would say, like Dr. Savannah mentioned, that time intercourse history would play a role. If the couple has been having very, very regularly time intercourse, then PCT would not make much difference. But yes, if they give a history that they haven't been regular, they haven't been using the fertile period, then whether to decide whether to give them more natural method of conception or to go IUI or IVF, then PCT can play a role.
Beautifully summed up. Yeah, exactly. Only thing I would say is that first time intercourse, and maybe we should go for tubal patency because 3 years, as you correctly mentioned. Okay, so investigations, it is post-coital test is not recommended as a routine investigation of the infertile couple. Even sperm function test we do not need, because here we have just seen the semen analysis is normal and we do not need to go into details of sperm function test. It is to be done only when we consider the patient for IVF. Routine investigations, hysteroscopy even is not needed. Sometimes we are planning for hysteroscopy or something else. Okay. So now coming to HSG, Dr. Puneet, can you please sum, do we need an endometrial biopsy for all patients to before HSG?
If it's a 3-year duration and she gives any history of previous pelvic infections or pulmonary tuberculosis or things like that, yes, and it is mandatory to rule out pelvic tuberculosis. So normally in my practice I talk about a patient with 3-year duration, I do normally endometrial biopsy for
I would just add that we do a mid-cycle scan around day 12 to 14. If the endometrium is trilaminar, beautiful, 8 to 9 millimeter, and with good vascularity, we usually do not go for endometrial biopsy. But before doing a HSG, yeah, we go for an endometrial biopsy and rule out tuberculosis. And Dr. Aditya, can you mention the role of HSG?
No, I little bit differ with the matter. Initial investigations, why we should go for this or laparoscopy with HSG? 26-year-old with good anthropology count, So those robotic accuracy may not be having any credit technologies. So she has not been prepared at all. So initially 2 to 3 cycles, why not some mobilization induction, some kind of medical intervention. And this is not conceiving, let alone we should have undergo, she should undergo the last pregnancy test.
Okay. So if the HSG shows some delayed spill or something, then you go for laparoscope.
Yes, if one tube is showing patent, you can wait for some time. If both the tubes are not showing patent, and maybe that case, after still you should give them a gap of 2 to 3 months or 4 months, and thereafter she can be advised for laparoscopy.
So I think here we have reached an agreement that it is the role of HSG, role of endometrial biopsy, and role of histolapro is definitely patient dependent. According to the patient, you have to decide that whether the patient needs to go for HSG, whether the patient needs some further diagnostic histolapro. Okay, Dr. Anupama.
I think we should agree to decide.
Yeah, yes. And as Dr. Parul sir already said, the moderator's words are final. So Dr. Puneet, how many IUI or timed intercourse? How long would you like to wait for this patient? Like how many cycles of timed intercourse or IUI would you recommend?
So if all is normal, let's say if it comes to a case where it's unexplained subfertility, you can give the patient the option of either timed intercourse or IUI. If you are doing timed intercourse, you can give monitored sex cycles. And if you are doing IUI, if all is normal, you should start considering after 3 cycles as to how to do, whether to give a 4th cycle or to proceed after that. So I think it should be in conjoint discussion with the patient. That is very, very important.
I think counseling plays a very important role here. Okay, so for tubal infertility, IVF should be considered first line of treatment. These are the ESHRE guidelines. Both surgery and IVF should be discussed without any bias to the patient. And there is no randomized comparison as of now between IVF and tubal surgery. So we can't decide. Okay, so Dr. Manisha, we have Dr. Manisha with us. Dr. Manisha, hi Dr. Manisha. This is a 32-year-old lady. She has a 32 BMI, PCOS, irregular cycles. Her AMH is 6.2. What will be your line of management as this patient?
As you have already tested her, the AMH is very high. So it is in PCO range. LHY, LHSS ratio more than 2 is also suggestive of PCO, her BMI is high. So PCO is a metabolic disorder in which there is raised LH, raised androgen, which leads to an ovulation. So I would like to know for how long she is married, what is the previous treatment history and her menstrual history.
The patient is married for 2.5 years and having irregular cycles. She has not taken any treatment till now. She has come to you for the first time.
Okay. Then I will do first day 2 ultrasound to confirm my diagnosis of PCO. If the retrostand shows more than 12 follicles in each ovary of less than 10 mm size and increased stromal echogenicity, then definitely she is PCO. And there are certain other investigations which I am not regularly doing. Fasting insulin level and fasting blood sugar to insulin level or GGT, because these patients are more prone for diabetic bladder, and DHEA level and testosterone level if she is not responding to any of the treatment. And regarding the line of management, these patients, since this is metabolic disorder, definitely lifestyle modification helps them a lot, in which the exercise plays an important role. Doing exercise for 5 days in a week or reducing 5 to 10% weight help these patients, and they respond better to the treatment and the dose required is also less. And they should decrease the caloric intake also, and decrease the foods which have high glycemic index. So lifestyle modification is the first line of management in such patients.
Would you like to wait for the lifestyle modification to act and then start stimulation?
Yeah, definitely.
No. You will give her some time frame further for 6 months and start stimulation?
No, not like that. Okay. They go hand in hand.
Yeah.
But we should give them some time, like 1 month or so in which we are waiting. So it will work.
Yes.
Give them some time.
Yes. Dr. Puneet, do you believe in insulin sensitizers?
These are, I would say, new drugs on the road, insulin sensitizers, bioanisole. They do have a logical sense in obese US patients with high glucose tolerance test and high, normally I don't do insulin, but I would say I go more on the oral glucose tolerance test. They do have a role in those. So yes, they do have a selective role, but if you look at the evidence, the randomized controlled trial, there's only a single randomized trial, and it doesn't support the use of such medications in our practice. But still, we are using it.
Rodasini, you two are using insulin sensitizers and bioanisole?
Actually, as for the guidelines, if you are going for an IVF, then in those cases, definitely, the problem is that you have a role in reducing the incidence of cold cases. But otherwise, if you're just going for ovulation induction in a first patient, usually we never use metformin or bioanisole as a regular treatment part. We have a documented insulin resistance, and it's where definitely metformin has its role.
So the panel agrees on the use of metformin, and bioanisole is still dicey. Diagnosis of PCOS is ultrasound guided. Dr. Savannah, would you like to please give us a brief briefing about how do you assess the ovarian reserve? What is the value of AMH? How do you assess the ovarian reserve?
Ovarian reserve, actually, we do not do for all the patients. We do for selection criteria, for selection patients. Usually, I do D2. Anything epithet, E2. And AMH level, we do I do from 4 or 4 or 5 to 9. D5 to D9. Then we assess on D gain, we assess the ratio. Otherwise, AMH, that you want to try to say okay.
Like I will be happy from 2 to 5 AMH. I will be happy with that. Okay. One thing, one counter. Yeah, please. Enter follicle count should be included in the ratio. Right. Many times we do see that AMH levels are low, but the fair amount of follicle counts is always available. So, with experience, what I have learned is the most important is to enter follicle count along with AMH.
Yes. Exactly. Sometimes the lab values are not that reliable. Sometimes what we believe is what we see. Okay. So I think even enteral follicle count deserves more merit than the AMH values.
Yeah, but AMH should be included.
Okay. The first drug of choice, Dr. Puneet, for inducing this patient?
I would go with oral antihistamines.
Dr. Marcus, can you hear us? Dr. Marcus?
Yes, I can hear you.
Okay, I just wanted to know your input about letrozole, because letrozole is banned here. I just wanted your views, how it is used worldwide. And like it can be used as a first drug of choice for PCOS or not?
We are using letrozole as a first choice everywhere in the world. It is much better than clomid because it does not affect the bleeding.
Change.
And we consider it as a safe drug. I don't know why in India it is banned.
Okay, thank you. Okay. So, first drug of choice, worldwide else, it is letrozole. India still with clomiphene only. And how would you monitor the cycles, Dr. Manisha?
First of all, they do ultrasound to check if there is any cells.
Now we are monitoring the cycles. Now we have then stimulated the patient.
Day 7 ultrasound followed by day 9, day 11 to check how the follicle is growing and how many follicles are growing.
Okay.
With PC, we can have these PCO patients, they have many follicles which are sensitive to CC. So they may be more than single follicles, which is of more than 14 mm or dominant follicle.
Any role of doing E2 values here, Dr. Anupama?
E2 Correctly
said. And what would be the choice of trigger, Dr. Sunny?
In the case of PCOS, and then we are expecting that there can be chances of ovulation. We are monitoring the cycle and we are getting two cycles. If it is only ovulation induction, then you can give a trigger test to be good monitoring. But if it is the IVF, definitely that should not be generalized earlier. At the best.
Okay. Because the risk of OHSS is always there, we give trigger with GnRH agonist. And if we give trigger with GnRH agonist, what extra precautions would you take in the luteal phase?
I would like to take some input from madam. Madam, you are discussing ovulation induction and issues, particularly baseline, we are considering for IV or without IV, definitely issues is not for IV. So in that case, unless otherwise there is some ultrasound package which the patient may go for OHSS, I think still we should give HCG trigger only, primary trigger.
Yeah, that
is
what I said. If it is the ovulation induction cycle and you are not seeing any that the patient has a chance to go because we are monitoring if the ultrasound molecule, then definitely the trigger is HCG only. We can give dual trigger also with half of
Dual trigger is usually, Dr. Manisha, for the IVF. Yes. For IUI, we usually don't recommend dual trigger. If we have to go, if there are more than 4-5 follicles, more than 14 millimeter size, we can convert the cycle to even IVF. Dr. Is not that good. Yes.
In that case, we can do some modification in the membrane and the cover open. We can get a small figure that has the 30 hours followed by the IVM.
Okay.
So therefore, in fact, we have to do some for the
modification.
Okay. So, we can put the mentioned data on the for the membrane.
Okay.
That would have been done on the membrane of the membrane of the membrane.
Okay.
So, we are not doing a mentioned data on the membrane.
So you mean to say that we give a short trigger for 30 hours only and then how much time do you give for?
Okay.
And what is the period you are? And Dr. Jain, how much is the period for maturation you give to the oocyte IVM? After taking out, how long? How many hours? 24 hours. And next day you do ICSI. Thank you. Dr. Puneet, your inputs on minimal stimulation protocols, please.
I would use minimal stimulation protocols in many broadly two cases, I would say. The one which are poor responders. Poor responders means they have behaved poorly in the feeding cycle or in ovarian reserve with antifollicular count and AMH is suggested on the lower side. And secondly, I would use more in cases there is a financial implication because in those patients, I think it can be justified.
Yeah.
And we get good results in those patients.
The purpose of minimal stimulation protocol is just to get 4 to 6X, do not overstimulate the ovaries. So the cost of gonadotropins used is very less and patient gets good quality oocytes and definitely good pregnancy rate. So for ovulation disorders, we all agree that clomiphene is an effective choice here. Yeah.
We don't have
letrozole
here. For minimal stimulation, We can use clomiphene
also, but the thing is that then if we use clomiphene, we prefer to freeze all. We do not do transfer in that cycle. Because if we use clomiphene in 100 milligram doses, the effect on the lining is bad. We just freeze all and transfer in the next cycle. Ovulation induction for with clomiphene is the line of choice here. And with clomiphene, 70 to 80% cumulative rate over 60%. 70% achieve pregnancy at doses of 100 milligram. More than 100 milligram is not recommended. And there is no advantage of using gonadotropin releasing hormone analogs in conjunction with gonadotropin for ovulation induction in women with clomiphene resistant PCOS. Okay. So next question, Dr. Aditya, please. 26-year primary infertility patient with regular cycles, normal hormonal profile, with a 30-year-old husband. The semen analysis shows azoospermia. What will be your line of action plan, and how will you treat this patient?
We had earlier discussion on this. We might speak to that because particularly coming to the female cycle, 26-year-old, and as normal hormonal profile in regular cycles. So, and a definite male factor is there. So, I don't want to spend money or time mostly on the female. Definitely,
no, Dr. Aditya, let's leave the money part aside because that is,
if the patient is also having money, also, it is also not recommended to do all basic investigations of the female, minimal investigation for the female, and we have to focus on the male factor because the definite factor is just for men's here.
No.
Then,
yes.
So, we have to evaluate the azoospermia, the cause of azoospermia, the levels where it has happened, whether it is treatable or not treatable. If it is treatable, whether some urosurgical solution is possible or not possible, or whether he needs some kind of retrieval and later on, it's see and all those things. And according to that, we have to evaluate the male partner, and definitely if the patient's financial concern is there, in those cases, donors may have to think. And if the patient is quite capable, then definitely in 2 days they are ICSI, we should always consider sperm retrieval
and ICSI. So the investigations say, the guidelines say that the male partner should normally have 2 semen analysis. Only 1 semen analysis you can't label as azoospermia. Laboratories that perform semen analysis should undertake according to WHO methods. Laboratories should practice internal quality control. In considering the result of semen analysis for the individual couple, it is important to take into account the duration of infertility and the woman's age and previous pregnancy history. Further investigations should be preceded by a clinical examination. So you should do whether to rule out whether it's obstructive or you should do a clinical examination of the male and then proceed further. The FSH LH levels should be done. If FSH LH levels are too high, you won't find any sperm even after doing a TESA. So there is no point in doing TESA for a FSH LH levels high. Testicular biopsy should be performed only in the context of a tertiary services. Okay. Dr. Anupama, coming to our next question. This is a 32-year-old lady, married since 4 years, regular cycles, but she has severe dysmenorrhea. History is suggestive of dyspareunia as well. She is euthyroid. There is delayed spill present on HSG. Semen is normal. So your line of management, please.
Well, at the outset, severe dysmenorrhea, which is taking my attention, and I am probably going to the audience, I would want to see this is that any patient with severe dysmenorrhea, you all should have very low threshold of suspecting endometriosis. This patient is also given history of dysmenorrhea, so we should be more skeptical about that. And this patient is married for 4 years. I would first like to do a good scan on her, and if the scan is suggesting something related to that, I usually see, with my experience, whatever I can add is that I usually see in an endometriotic patient, the uterus is many a times retroverted with endometriomas from luteicide. So in such a patient, I would want to see what her basic endometriosis count are. Because very fast, very, very fast, these endometriosis patients, they lose all their follicles, the ovarian reserve is lost very fast. So, the only take-home message for this slide would be that you should not sit and wait endometriosis patient. She needs an early treatment.
Now that early treatment can be IUI for a cycle since she's having still, but I would rather going for IUI. I would just I'm doing IUI to assess the dose of gonadotropin, what dose she's responding to. If she's not responding to say 150, I know that I have to go for a high. But basically it depends on what her AMH levels are, what her basic counts are. But then in IVF, my treatment protocol, how it could go, this depends. What that particular cycle which I have used, she has behaved in that.
So the point of here is that whether you proceed for histolapro or you proceed for giving OC pills to her and proceed stimulating in next cycle?
Medical management is for the mild one. Mild endometriosis is now out. That medical management, you should not waste time. For big endometriomas, definitely we should go for a surgery, because big ones, the 4 centimeter larger than that, they do need aspiration, because then they would interfere in our results. But then,
You would go for aspiration, or you would go for histolapro?
Histolapro, a gastric drain rather than aspiration.
Okay.
Then the main thing I would say is that don't waste time. Whatever decision you decided, move it fast. OCPs, I would really not waste my time doing the OCPs. If her criteria is infertility, if her problem is say not something efficient, then OCPs have a very good role. Now in this particular patient, I will actually do it.
So guidelines say that endometriosis should be classified according to the revised AFS system. Surgical ablation of minimal and mild endometriosis improves fertility in subfertile women. Medical treatment of minimal and mild endometriosis does not enhance fertility in subfertile women. Ovarian stimulation with intrauterine insemination is more effective than either no treatment or IUI alone in subfertile women. There is no evidence that medical management of moderate and severe endometriosis either alone or as an adjunct to surgery improves fertility. Surgical treatment of moderate and severe endometriosis may improve fertility, but controlled studies and comparisons with assisted reproduction techniques are required. In cases of moderate and severe endometriosis, assisted reproduction techniques should be considered as an alternative for following an unsuccessful surgery. Where large and ovarian endometriotic cysts are present, consideration should be given to their surgical treatment, because this may enhance spontaneous pregnancy and improve success if IVF is planned. Dr. Puneet, what would be the preferred protocol if this patient decides to go for IVF?
It will depend on the ovarian reserve law. So the protocol would be gonadotropin. I would not consider minimal stimulation in this patient. So there's a debate whether you give them long agonist protocol or antagonist protocol. And there has been a wonderful study from Denmark which has shown no difference in these two protocols.
Yes.
Traditionally, we have been thinking of long protocols for this. But then if you're using the entire protocol, then we should keep a low threshold for freezing the embryo and put it in a subsequent cycle. Because the logic is that entire protocol can aggravate the endometriosis and affect the pregnancy outcomes. So in a way, I would say if the ovarian reserve is good, you can consider long or short, doesn't matter. If the ovarian reserve is low, I would go for antagonist protocol.
Thank you, Dr. Puneet. Now, Dr. Marcus, this is 32-year-old primary infertility hypothyroid patient, married for... Dr. Marcus, you there?
Yes, I can see your slides.
Okay. This is a 32-year-old primary infertility lady with hypothyroid. She is on treatment with Thyronorm, stimulated with clomiphene citrate 100 mg for 5 days. Follicle monitoring was done in that cycle and IUI was done. The result of this cycle was negative. Now in the next cycle, on second day of her scan, she has a 14 mm follicle which is present in the right ovary. Can you please brief us on the management of this patient?
Okay, so she has had... clomiphene treatment, and she was triggered with HPV, right?
Yeah.
So this combination usually makes four dominant follicles or cysts in the subsequent cycle, because the clomiphene has a long half-life and still keeps acting in the body. And the same is true for HCG. So the combination of both keeps stimulating. So we have a cyst or dominant follicle in the subsequent cycle, and we cannot start a next treatment then.
Okay.
So what is the easiest way to act is to give the patient 0.2 mg decapeptyl to make this follicle rupture, and then give them 10 days of pills. After stopping the pills, we can restart the next cycle.
Okay.
Normally, the line of acting is giving the patient the pill for 2 or 3 months.
Okay.
Follicle or cyst is gone.
Okay. Dr. Marcus, you said the combination of clomiphene citrate and HCG has the cyst in the first half of the next cycle. So would you suggest triggering the patient with decapeptyl in the IUI cycles when the clomiphene citrate is used?
That would avoid that kind of problem, yes, definitely.
Okay. So I would like to have your views on luteal phase supports, Dr. Puni.
So it depends on whether the patient has been stimulated with one of the antiestrogens or nanoglobulins. And also it depends on number of follicles developing. The more the number of follicles developing and the nanoglobulins being used, then there is a strong role of luteal support. In case of single follicles with clomiphene, in those cases, we don't need to consider intense luteal phase supports.
Dr. Savannah, can you please mention few progesterone preparations we are using and what route would you prefer?
Here I would like to highlight again why I do thyroid profile for each and every patient. Hyper and hypothyroid, through an intricate mechanism, are known to have an impact on the liver. Throughout the preparations, I use many drugs in the market, but I usually use micronized progesterone, 200, 300, 400. From the Daniel order, it's part of the preference. And nowadays we have a newer progesterone injection about 15 to 20 milligram per day. Injection, the claim is painless. I don't know painless or not because I have not taken it. But this is painless. And the other drug like ECG injection, 1,500 to 2,000. But I stick to micronized progesterone, 200, 300, 400, is for the patient preference.
So there. American Society for Reproductive Medicine recommends using progesterone for luteal phase support, and it is strongly recommended in ASRM 2015. After vaginal preparations, the endometrial levels are very high. However, after the intramenstrual preparations, the serum levels are very high. So we just have a brief slide here using different routes. Definitely vaginal is preferred than any other route. Dr. Sini, now coming to our last question. This is a 32-year-old lady for IVF for antagonist protocol, started stimulation with 300 IU of FSH. On day 10, on ultrasound, there were good 8 to 10 follicles of about 18 to 20 millimeters seen in the both the ovaries. Endometrium here is 7.8, trilaminar, but there is a minimal fluid in cavity. How would you manage this case?
Actually, this presence of fluid in cavity is a very distressing clinical thing for the cavity clinician actually. And when you see this, actually, it's very unclear as to what is the origin or source of this fluid. Can be a fluid which has reflux from the hydrocephalus. And sometimes it will also see in cases where there is no hydrocephalus also. So once you see this fluid, it becomes a very tricky situation because sometimes during the gonadotropin stimulation phase and the HCG, you see the fluid. But at the time of transfer, you usually see that the fluid has disappeared. But in spite of that, and in some cases, it still persists. But even if it disappears, it is the presence, once you have seen fluid during the cycle, it is said to have an intense impact on pregnancy and implantation. So particularly in these cycles, counseling is very important. You need to counsel the patient. And you have to cancel maybe transfer in that particular cycle, and you have to plan transfer in the cycle.
Maybe freeze all is the option in that case.
There are studies saying about this transmitter transfer, but practically I have never done that.
No.
So obviously, we prefer to cancel the cycle transfer in that cycle.
Okay. So coming to some newer concepts, Dr. Manisha, I would like to have your views on GCSF installation.
GCSF is a cytokine which causes macrophages proliferation and neutrophilic granulocyte proliferation in anomalia in residual cells. So it has found some role in endometrial proliferation, especially in thin unresponsive endometrium, which is not responding to traditional treatments like estrogen, sildenafil, and aspirin. So there are many studies which have shown that there is increase in the endometrial thickness if it is given on the day of ovulation. On the day of rupture, 6 to 8 hours before giving rupture, and to check the endometrial thickness 48 hours after on the day of pickup, and we can repeat the injection on the day also. So these studies have shown that they have role in thin endometrium and recurrent implantation failure, and also some role in recurrent miscarriages. But still, there need some more studies and some more data to confirm whether they are really effective or not.
In my small experience, I would like to say that I have seen GCSF installation works in some cases. It does not work at all in some other cases.
Yeah.
Second thing is that it might improve endometrial thickness a bit, but it definitely improves the endometrial vascularity.
Yeah.
And third thing is that we are putting GCSF installation on days 7, 9 and 11 for IUI cycles.
Okay.
For the IVF cycles, we are doing as you are doing on the trigger.
There are some studies which some people, they are also doing this, that they are giving it subcutaneously.
No, subcutaneously it does not. No. Intrauterine installation has to be done. Subcutaneously it does not work.
Yeah.
Dr. Anupama, can you please add on DHEA and other adjuvants which are used in?
DHEA is much in both cases. We can prescribe DHEA. And I would just add that DHEA is mainly for premature ovarian failure poor responder patients. It is not for any infertility patients that DHEA is prescription is given. And DHEA is basically a pro hormone which is required, which is normally produced in our body from the adrenal cortex and from the ovary cells. And if we are supplementing this for a while, say if we are giving DHEA for more than 3 months, then we are giving that precursor in the body, and that precursor can increase the androgen content, and later on it can improve the results in ovarian failure patients. Number of oocyte pickups has been found to improve. But then again, there is much controversy and much more studies are required.
DHEA works in some cases, it doesn't at all in some other cases. And basically again, it is age dependent. A lady young age having poor ovarian reserve will be benefited by DHEA, but not a older one. Dr. Sinney, can you please tell us something about endometrial scratching?
Endometrial scratching is actually an induced injury which is done to the endometrium, usually in the cycle, which is the previous cycle, the cycle before when you are planning to do IVF or a controlled ovarian stimulation. So in the previous cycle, you have to do this endometrial scratching, just like a biopsy or like taking a pure biopsy from the endometrium. And the concept is that by doing this induced injury, you're causing the release of some growth factors and some cytokines which are important for implantation, embryo implantation. And there are lots of studies also which shows the benefits of embryo implantation by doing a scratching. And also they have shown that scratching causes benefits in, by creating a synchrony between the endometrium and the embryo to be implanted in the subsequent cycle.
Dr. Aditya, can you please tell us about progesterone elevation in a stimulated cycle?
Yes, if you are suggesting about premature illness or premature development of the follicles, and also speak about the part of the cycle and the cycles and the progression of the pickup of the eggs and the storage of the embryos, and later on we can transfer the subsequent cycle, maintaining the growth and development.
Dr. Marcus, can you please give us your input about natural cycle transfer? How do you go about it? And is it beneficial in some ways?
Natural cycle transfers?
Yeah.
Yes. I think all transfers work, all endometrium preparations work the same way. The benefits of natural cycle preparation is that you use much less medicine. That's the most important point. There's no advantage in pregnancy rates or others. Only in the you save medicine.
Okay. Do you think that we need to monitor these cycles in some specific ways? How are the monitoring of cycles different than the other cycles, normal cycles?
So if you use a natural cycle preparation, of course, it is very, very important that you exactly know when the ovulation happens, because you have to adjust the transfer of the embryos according to this. If you have an artificial preparation, then this is not so of such importance, only when you start with progesterone.
Thank you, Dr. Marcus. Okay. Dr. Ajay, can you please give something new, like oocyte freezing? What is the scope of oocyte freezing and what?
Oocyte freezing, I should say a little bit wider term. Freezing is a very applied and good procedure to the solution of the infertility. But in this case, I would like to make a little clear. Cryofeasibility is a way which can decide the successful outcome of a freezing. That can vary from person to person. But in embryo and oocyte freezing, there is no way to check the cryofeasibility. If we are freezing the sperms, then we can check the cryofeasibility by freezing and by thawing. This much is the percentage of the successful outcome of a retrieval. In certain cases, the retrieval may be 70 to 90% in assuming so many cases. But in oocyte, because they are in limited number, and embryo are also in very limited number, so that can be not possible to check the successful outcome of retrieval after freezing and thawing. In that case, we should make comfortable and informative to the patient concerned that we can take a chance, as you are talking about the natural cycle, that we can have only when we are having the frozen embryo or oocyte. But that can't be 100% a guarantee that the whatsoever number we are freezing will be retrieved as such. There is a chance that all may be retrieved by any technique, whether that is a vitrification, whether that is a slow freezing, or whether that is any other technique, or any media. But 100% retrieval is not possible in all the cases.
Dr. Puneet, NOVA is, I think, using oocyte freezing a lot. So could you please give your inputs on that?
Yeah, I would say that oocyte freezing is now giving us very good results. The technology is advancing. We are doing oocyte freezing both for cancer patients who are undergoing chemotherapy.
That is fertility preservation.
We are doing oocyte freezing for patients for social reasons, those who haven't found the right man, right partner.
Yeah.
And thirdly, in some special circumstances, especially in religious conditions, where let's say the pizza is and the female are put kept on the same day, and unfortunately we don't find samples in pizza and they don't agree for donor sperm insemination. So in those cases, oocyte freezing.
And what do you say about the results?
The results are very good. Recently, I would say my personally, we just do thaw and transfers and inseminations. Both of them got
pregnant. Yes.
So, yes, I think the technology is
improving
and
yes.
It is working.
It depends upon the experience of the embryologist. We also at AWARE doing oocyte freezing and we have got a very good results with oocyte freezing. We also recently got a pregnancy with that only. So, minimal stimulation protocols we just touched upon. Dr. Anupama, yeah, please.
Is there any difference of the time that of the oocyte tubing, when you are using after a year, after 10 years, do you really find any difference?
Yes. Nothing other than that.
Other than that, yeah, it's safe. But according to the Indian law, we have to take consent for initial 3 years, and then it has to be updated. Other than that, clinically and lab-wise, it's safe to use for a number of years.
So luteal phase support, there is, Dr. Puneet, could you please add something about GnRH agonist in mid-luteal phase? We are using that as a luteal phase support now.
So GnRH as a...
luteal phase support.
Yeah. So I would say that my personal experience is very low in this. I've not used much as a luteal phase support. I've been using the traditional what we discussed, the progesterone and all that stuff. But the data is reassuring. So it looks and it makes logical sense to sort of use it because it sort of gives the support, initial part, it gives support to the dying edge, the corpus luteum. It keeps it going. So hopefully it should give us good results.
So the Cochrane 2012 review says that the single dose of 0.5 milligrams subcutaneous on 6th day after ICSI. It increases the implantation rate, CPR per transfer, and increases live birth rate, single dose GnRH agonist. Addition of GnRH agonist to progesterone improved outcome of live birth, clinical pregnancy, and ongoing pregnancy. So with this, I conclude my talk. The only thing I would like to add is that one satisfied patient is worth thousands of guidelines and protocols. So you have to individualize, you have to see the patient, what the patient wants, and tailor-made the treatment. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much, Dr. Nisha. I think all of our queries about infertility, about ovarian stimulation, about egg freezing, about endometrium are all cleared now. And I would like you to congratulate you for such a beautiful session. And I would like Dr. Anita Rasogi and Dr. Sabha Asar to please present a memento to Dr. Nisha Bhatnagar, our moderator.
Thank you, Dr. Marcus, for logging in. And we are really sorry because we could, for waking you up so early. I think it was midnight when you woke up and you were rubbing your eyes and we could make out that you were just out from the bed. We are really very sorry, but thank you so much.
Thank you.
A big round of applause for Dr. Marcus also. Dr. Nisha, please present a memento to Dr. Tini, Dr. Anupam, Dr. Puneet.
And Dr. Marcus can now smile. So he's now wide awake after the panel discussion.
Dr. Nisha, please do the honors for Dr. Tini. Acha, please, they are having a group photograph.
Yeah.
Dr. Sini Venugopal, yes, Dr. Savana, Dr. Manisha Jain, Dr. Puneet and Dr. Aditya. Mm-hmm.
Dr. Aditya has lost his laptop from here. Someone has picked it up.
I'm so Mr. A.K. Jain.
Anyone finds it, please give it to him.
Embryologist. Ma'am, please a momento also for our chairperson, Dr. Anita Rastogi and Dr. Sabha Asher. Dr. Anita Rastogi. And Dr. Sabha Asher. Thank you so much. Thanks. Thanks to all of you. Now we are having Dr. Charu Mittal with us on yes, on the web, and she'll be telling us about the need for Indian medical services. And I would like to invite Dr. Premlata Sridhar and Dr. Bhanu Rastogi to please chair the session. Dr. Bhanu, is he here? Dr. Pragati Gupta? Dr. Sangeeta Gupta, would you like to chair the session? Dr. Sridhar and Dr. Sangeeta Gupta, please chair the session. Dr. Charu, now you can start your, show your slides.
Good afternoon, ma'am. Nice to join.
Yeah, decrease your volume a bit.
Okay.
Dr.
Is this okay?
A bit more.
Dr. Sridhar, please introduce Dr. Charu Mittal to the audiences. Hello, hello everyone. I am giving the introduction of Dr. Charu Mittal. She is Assistant Professor Ops and Gynae, Government Medical College, Baroda, Gujarat. Presently Consultant Ops Gynae in Gwalior since 2007. Joint Secretary AMPU GS 2003-2015. Past President Baroda Ops and Gynae Society 2004-2005. Editor of two books, Emergencies in Obstetrics and Gynecology, 2006, Decision Making in Obstetrics and Gynecology, 2008. Managing Editor, Journal of Indian Medical Research and Ethics Association, Peer Reviewer, GOGI since 2014. National Faculty for various policy workshops and CMEs such as RPL, Medical Legal Issues, Critical care and obstetric safe motherhood and practical skills and drills to reduce maternal mortality postnatal care workshops. Active member of various policy committee like safe motherhood, medical legal and ethics, study of female breast, public awareness, adolescent health, medical disorders in pregnancy, various lectures and panel discussion, scientific paper and poster presentation. Best Paper Award at Best Zone Yuva Policy 2003 and Best Zone Yuva Policy 2013. Various publications and chapters, scientific papers, articles with winner of Youth Lady Doctor Award 2009 at Gwalior. Now I invite Dr. Charu Mittal to please give their important and informative action. Thank you.
Dr. Charu, you can start with your talk now. Dr. Charu? Hello, Dr. Charu, can you hear me?
Dr. Charu. Hello. Dr. Charu, you can start speaking now. Hello.
Hello. So I think Dr. Charu is offline. Till she connects, we continue with the same chairpersons, and I would like to invite Dr. Neeraj Nagpal if he is here for his talk.
Hello.
Yeah. Hi, Dr. Charu.
Yeah. Actually, the connection was lost for some time. Sorry for the short delay. Thank you so much for this opportunity to be with you all. The special topic that has been allotted to me is need for IMS. That is the Indian Medical Services. It's a unique concept.
Dr. Charu,
I would like to present before everyone. Yeah, some query?
Yeah, just lower down your volume a little bit.
Is this okay?
Yeah, yeah. Now this one.
Yeah, fine. So basically, thank you so much for the introduction. I would like to just go ahead with this. As doctors today, we know that we are trying very hard to cope up with many challenges, including the Nursing Home Act, the MTP Act, PCPNDT Act, the CPA, CEA, biomedical waste, etc., etc. Other than this, it's also that we are constantly under threat of mob violence. These are the headlines we get to see so many days, and it's very upsetting to most of us. And so many issues like the Doctors Protection Act have been implemented. It's debatable, however, how much effective they are. And when any of us doctors receives a legal notice, unfortunately, whether it is from an advocate or from the consumer court, then what is our reaction? I guess it's something like this. Confused, tense, and obviously quite worried. So in my opinion, what is the one-stop solution for all these difficulties? I think perhaps it's now time for change and to think a little differently along something which we can call as the Indian Medical Services or the IMS. What is this concept? For that, I would request all people who are listening in, please keep the current situation in which we are existing aside for the next few minutes, because to understand this concept, we'll have to abandon the establishments that we are following till today.
Dr. Charu, your audio is not working. Have you muted yourself? Okay.
Hello. Dr. Charu, your connection is going offline all the time. So I'm disconnecting you just now and we are proceeding with the next talk. And then you just check with your connection and we'll get back to you.
Till then, I invite Dr. Neeraj Nagpal for his talk on violence and medical legal problems in obs and gyne. Dr. Neeraj Nagpal has done his MBBS from CMC Ludhiana and his MD medicine also from the same institute. He is fellow of Internal Medicine Medical Sciences Academy, FIMSA. And currently, he is Director of Hope Gastrointestinal Diagnostic Clinic, Chandigarh, and convener Medicos Legal Action Group, which is a registered trust. With these words, I invite Dr. Neeraj Nagpal for his talk. Dr. Shamli Datta, is she here?
Presentation methodology and protocol.
Hello.
I'm extremely sorry for this confusion. I'm thankful to be invited here to Muradabad. Usually, I would love to start this particular talk with a short video, which probably most of you may have already seen. Leave it.
coming.
Something in Metro Parity Rock have been rooted and assaulted in Hardwar has become, has come to light. In fact, the moon of the country was assaulted by the husband of a pregnant baby after the sun reports show the baby had died in the womb. The rooted and assault was called on CCTV camera while the ceiling was.
I just learned we lose 1,30,000 mothers per year in India from various causes of maternal mortality. Well, if we are going to lose one obstetrician for every maternal mortality death, we have total 9 lakh plus doctors of qualified system of medicine, MBBS and above in the country. So 9 years should deplete all of us. Point remains, we are still not focusing on this issue as much as we probably should. I will try and rush through because we have already delayed and I know everybody is hungry. Gynecologists, like all others, are under Consumer Protection Act, PCPNDT Act, Clinical Establishment Act. This is the devil, deep sea, and PCPNDT I usually consider the dragon. So what are the problems which can occur? A person, a patient can complain to your employer, a compensation case can be filed in consumer court, an FIR can be lodged, complaint can be filed in state medical council, MCI for medical negligence, civil suit can be filed for compensation in civil courts, complain to appropriate authority to cancel your PCPNDT and Clinical Establishment Act registration. Violence can also be done against you or your hospital. This was not enough. So now National Human Rights Commission has stepped in and a person can make a complaint to National Human Rights Commission also alleging medical negligence and seeking relief from them. And in fact, National Human Rights Commission... did not know this. The fact remains, the court can award a compensation which is more than what has been asked for by the complainant. When we do something, there is something which goes wrong. This. Now in this case, compensation of rupees 3200 only was awarded. The government hospital went into state commission, which said no compensation to be paid. And this case further went to national commission. No, actually the government hospital went to the national commission. And national commission, for a case where 3200 only was originally demanded by the complainant, because this is the amount he had spent in the private hospital where the district hospital had sent him. Because this was appealed in National Commission, the National Commission decided to fine the hospital 5 lakhs. Original compensation asked for 3200. Mind you, interest on compensation which has been awarded, it can be as low as 6% or as high as 18%. And there is nobody to ask the judiciary what is the interest which has to be paid on the compensation which is awarded against me. In this particular case, directed to pay 10,000 only to the complainant, whereas hospital was to pay 4,95,000 with interest of 18% per annum from 15/9/1988 till 2015. The amount of interest will be much, much, much more than the compensation awarded. Kunal Saha case, they awarded only 6% interest. And still the compensation jumped from 8 lakhs to 11.5 crores. Imagine if they had awarded 18% interest, what would have happened? And nobody can question the judiciary who decides how much interest is to be paid and since when. Interest from 6% to 18%, some court's judgments say from date of filing the case originally, some say 30 days after the judgment, till which time doctor has time to pay compensation, after which interest is to be charged. It is not clarified also whether this interest is going to be simple or compound. These are all issues which our organizations should be taking up. And in India, another very interesting thing is compassionate. Patient poor at aksab ki farak penda kuchhi ta insured. What nonsense. Here in this case, the patient gave a forged affidavit stating that his daughter is to get married, so the money which has been deposited by the doctors for filing an appeal. When you file an appeal, you have to file a person, you have to deposit a particular percentage of the compensation which has been awarded by the lower court. From that compensation which was to be deposited, the patient says, my daughter is to be married and so kindly release me this amount so that I can use it. The court awarded him, fine, you take it, pending what happens later. Later what happened, the next court overruled this judgment, so no compensation is to be paid. But let us say what the National Commission has to say. It is unfortunate that the complainant has lost his son. Due to circumstantial reality, we take a sympathetic view and request opposite parties not to recover the money already withdrawn by the complainant. And mind you, this affidavit which he had given in court that his daughter is to get married was false. His daughter was already married many years ago. Despite that, this judgment was given. Reply not filed within 45 days. Your right to reply gets forfeited. You still have to defend the allegations. But lot of doctors sometimes have this tendency ki notice aaya dekhenge kya karna hai. Within 45 days you are to file the reply. In case you have not filed and you have not given documents to support your stand, then you lose the right to file any supportive documents later on in the case. Please remember this. Cause for all this, very poor image of the medical profession. We have very low health literacy. There is very poor budgetary allocation to health. Rising healthcare costs, definite problem. But poor communication, we are also at fault sometimes. We tend to be a bit paternalistic when it comes to treating our patients. This is a problem. We need to start learning how to communicate. This study is what I had referred to earlier. Earlier we had conducted this. Out of 513 cases, we had found 20.8% reported against the gynecologists. The allegations, death, the situations were death of mother due to amniotic fluid embolism, PPH, pulmonary embolism, whatever. Death of newborn, birth asphyxia, premature birth, retinopathy of prematurity, forceps delivery causing focal neurological deficit. Financial reasons at the time of billing, especially after birth of a female child, that too by cesarean, more so premature, requiring neonatal ICU care. These are all issues on which allegations of medical negligence are made. And what were the specific allegations? Did not do the triple marker test, not doing level 2 ultrasound, not doing thalassemia screening. All these are specific cases. Anybody wants references, more than enough available. Not having pediatrician available during delivery. Not having neonatal ICU in a nursing home. One judge has gone to the extent of saying, if you didn't have neonatal ICU, why did you conduct the delivery? Not getting premature child examined by an ophthalmologist. Not referring to a higher center. Not providing CTG traces. Not doing cesarean or doing unnecessary cesarean. So there are certain sure shot ways in which you can minimize your medical legal problems. One is retire, change your profession, divorce, then remarry an advocate, politician or an IPS officer. Let us come to the specifics, how to preempt and prevent indemnity insurance. I would have loved to ask, because in PGI Chandigarh, in one of the conferences, I had asked this question, how many of you are insured for indemnity insurance? Out of 150 or 200 people who were there, just 10 people raised their hands. Whereas I have 18 cases with me where PGI allegations have been made against doctors working in PGI. And despite that, there was only 10% adherence to the necessity for taking professional indemnity insurance. I was shocked. I was to give a lecture in Indian Society of Gastroenterology in Indore recently. My professor and head of hepatology in PGI, Dr. J.B. Dilawari, he was there and I had learnt all my endoscopies from him. So I had just asked him before the event, he said, have you taken insurance? And he said, no. And he was working in Max Hospital, Mohali. Mostly he had worked outside, but he had recently come. So I made an example of him in that talk. And after that, he came to us and took indemnity insurance from us, from MLAG indemnity itself. And sure enough, within less than 1 month, a patient of his died in Max Hospital. There was a big dharna. The patient was a sarpanch of one of the villages and he was a Kali Dal member. The brother of the patient was a police officer. An FIR was lodged against Dr. Dilawari. And he thanked me from the bottom of his heart. You are the one who told me to take the insurance, otherwise I don't know what I would have done. So when we talk of how to prevent and preempt, insurance is one very important feature. And doctors are frequently underinsured, incompletely insured, fraudulently insured, unknowingly insured, or uninsured. To practice medicine in a government service, charitable hospital, post-retirement small clinic in a residence, government institute like PGI, civil hospital, ESI hospital, even army hospitals. Lot of people have this impression, I'm working in an army hospital or an ESI hospital, I don't require insurance. You do. Please be 110% sure. Doctors working in this university, they do require professional indemnity insurance besides the hospital being insured under errors and omissions policy. That is a separate thing. Sudha Garg, Union of India. There is still a debate whether army doctors are covered under Consumer Protection Act. But mind you, before Consumer Protection Act came, there is under law of torts, for civil negligence, I can be sued in civil courts. And High Court here had given a judgment awarding 12 lakhs to this person against army doctors. And two army doctors had to pay this amount. So to tell me that doctors working in government service or army hospital do not require to take professional indemnity insurance, it is foolhardy. I have a number of other cases of army hospital. When you take insurance, please do not ask the insurance agent to fill whatever he has to fill and sign. Please fill the proposal forms yourself. If you do not inform the insurance company that a liability has occurred, the insurance company will refuse to pay, even though the court may award against you and even though you may have been insured. Another thing, unfair trade practices are not covered by insurance. Orthopedic doctor claiming to be stone specialist, doing ECA, extracorporeal shockwave lithotripsy, the court held this is unfair trade practice. If you do not adhere to the terms and conditions of the policy, the company, even though you are insured, will refuse and the courts will side with the company. When you take a proposal form, in the proposal form is written, where do you practice? You have to mention, I practice in my nursing home, but I also practice in other hospitals and nursing homes of the city in an emergency if called. If you write this thing, it is covered. What happened over here? Doctor was insured to operate in his clinic. He went to another hospital, operated a cataract, patient died. Insurance company says, we are covering you for any negligence you commit within your premises. In your proposal form, you have not mentioned this thing that you will be operating elsewhere. So please fill the proposal forms properly. Error and omission policy for the hospital, whether it is a nursing home, whether it is a medical university, whether it is a government hospital, has to be over and above and separate from personal professional indemnity insurance that doctors are to take. Insurance should be in the name of hospital as well as individual doctors. Again, I can keep on giving examples, but my message is do not be cheap. Take policy in name of all doctors as well as hospitals separately. Even if you are going to have one doctor come and give anesthesia once a month, your hospital requires separate policy of errors and omissions. You require a separate policy as a gynecologist. Again, number of examples. Just for 7.5% extra, unqualified attendants working in your hospital, all of us have unqualified attendants, their negligence will be covered. Please pay that 7.5% extra. If you don't go in appeal and the insurance company goes in appeal, what happened in this case? The doctor says, my technique of operation was perfect. It is the eye drops which were put which must have been contaminated. That is why the infection occurred. Now the doctor did not go and appeal against the judgment which was given. Insurance company says, we are there to cover for negligence of the doctor, and the doctor himself has said that there is no negligence in this case. This is a problem related to drug. So how are we involved in this case? And the court said, fine. Compensation has to be paid by the doctor. What is AOA versus AOI? Any one accident in any one year. When the agent comes to you, he gives you a figure, you say, nahi, nahi, bhai, ye bahut zyada mehenga. He says, achha, doctor saab, main thoda kam kar deta hun. What is he doing? Instead of ratio 1:1, he simply reduces the ratio to 1:4. You think you have negotiated a very good deal. Actually, he has given you not a policy of 10 lakhs, he has given you a policy of 2.5 lakhs. Because for any one accident, you will be covered not for 10 lakhs insurance which you have taken, but only for 2.5 lakhs. You will be covered for 4 incidents of 2.5 lakhs each, but in any individual case, the insurance company will not pay more than 2.5 lakhs. So when you take an insurance, please take 1:1. Government doctor, I've already covered. Cause of action prior to onset of policy. Obviously, we know if the accident has occurred earlier and you take an insurance policy now, that is not going to be covered. Government doctors, hospitals, all covered. Question arises, how much should a person be insured for? If compensation asked is for 50 lakhs and doctor says in the court, ki ji, I am insured with this company for 1 crore, the court takes a very lenient view and says, fine, anyway, he is a rich doctor, he has taken an insurance for 1 crore. The patient has only asked for 50 lakhs, let us award 50 lakhs. He still has 50 lakhs remaining in his insurance policy. If the doctor takes 2 insurances of 25 lakh each from different companies and declares only 1 in court, but the amount which has been asked for is 50 lakhs and court by some reason awards the 50 lakhs, he has given only 1 example of New India Assurance, ki ji, I am covered by this company and that is the only company which is representing. Tomorrow when the question comes and he says ki nahi ji, I was also covered by Oriental Insurance, Oriental Insurance will deny any payment. So what is the ideal? Ideal is, if you want to take high insurances, take multiple insurances from the same company. Declare 1 insurance policy in court. Let the court award compensation up to the limit of this policy. Let the court feel you have policy only of 20 lakhs. You may have 4 policies of 20 lakhs each. But the court will award only 20 lakhs and it will also award New India Assurance to make the payment. Now, when New India Assurance is there to make the payment and supposing the award is 50 lakhs, you can simply place the other policies also on record and say, okay, New India Assurances doesn't cover me for 20 lakhs only. So I had told you we are covered with New India. The policy numbers by mistake were not written. But if the policy is from 2 different, then you have to give the name of the insurance company. So if you are going to take high insurances, take multiple insurances from same company. Next thing comes is consent, not a formality. Lot of detailed discussions need to be done on consent. Use the language of the patient, use simple non-medical terms. Take high-risk consent where any of these situations is there. And also in cases of troublesome patient, and in the list of troublesome patients, I include judges and advocates. Consent, yes, you can have a model consent, but please make sure you write in your model consent, ki, I do not have blood bank, ICU, ventilator, dialysis, ambulance, whatever. Tomorrow you should not be caught in this situation, ki, you did not tell. Apollo Hospital has been sued and awarded against by an oncology patient. On what grounds? Ki, ji, I was not told they do not have machine to monitor methotrexate levels. Because this was not mentioned in my consent that they do not have machine to monitor methotrexate levels, that is why I should be awarded compensation. So at least in our consent, let us write, we do not have a ventilator, we do not have NICU, we do not have ambulance, we do not have whatever, but please mention it. Other thing gynecologists can do to prevent and preempt is avoid jousting. Patient has had one ANC checkup done in with one gynecologist and comes to another gynecologist for the delivery. By action, by words, by written, try not to make the other gynecologist any lesser than you. Whatever the patient's reasons may have been, they are best known to the patient. If the patient can ill-mouth the previous gynecologist, be sure the same patient can ill-mouth you also. Teaching hospitals, be very careful when we are teaching students. Some patient brought from private sector, some patient brought from some private practitioner, and the tone and tenor is as if the private practitioner and the private doctor has no idea what he has done and we are going to be next to God. The patient is listening and when he goes back home, he catches hold of the referring doctor. Improve your documentation. And when you document, please sign whatever you have documented. National Commission 14 March 2016 has very clearly mentioned an unsigned medical record has no legal validity. Not only should your record be complete, they should be complete and signed. Kunal Saha, the patient had died in Breach Candy Hospital. Where was the compensation awarded? Against AMRI Hospital, Calcutta. Why was Breach Candy Hospital left out? Because Breach Candy Hospital documentation was so excellent that they had put the onus of death of the wife of this complainant on the complainant himself. He was too interfering. He ordered us to give these medicines. The doctor clearly wrote, "Ji, I do not agree with this medicine. I agree with this medicine. I don't think this medicine will make any difference. So I am allowing this thing. This I am refusing." And he signed it in the records. National Commission, for the second time when it took up this case, decided 1.73 crores as compensation, and 10% was to be paid by Dr. Kunal Saha himself. I don't know whether this thing is known. So then when he went to Supreme Court, he deleted Breach Candy Hospital from the array of opposite parties. Reason? Because the documentation of Breach Candy was much, much better than that of AMRI Hospital. Another many instances where documentations have saved the doctors. Improve your communication. Paternalistic approach to patient-centered approach. This is something we have to learn. It is difficult, I know, in India, health literacy is so poor, illiteracy is so rampant, to suddenly change gear from first to fifth, it becomes a problem. Because the persons who are going to sue us expect us to be absolutely work in the same fashion as a doctor in US works when he is doing 3 endoscopies in a day. Not when he is doing 30 endoscopies in a day and when he doesn't have time to even know the patient's name. Within 3 minutes out of the endoscopy room. Not only do you need to communicate, you also need to document. And remember, in China, there was a study which was done recently. China has a lot of violence against doctors. I don't know if you are aware of that or not. They had conducted a study because a lot of people say, improve your security, improve your security. They actually conducted a study. They improved the security. The incidences of violence actually went up. The only thing which reduced incidences of violence was communication. When a problem occurs, when you say sorry to a patient, you are not acknowledging that you are at fault. You are sorry for the situation the patient is in. You are empathizing. Maintain a line of communication. Patients will die. If they don't die in hospitals or with doctors, where else are they going to die? It is us who have to learn to handle these patients and their relatives. Problem is, we are taught postpartum hemorrhage, but we are not taught how to deal with the consequences which follow the postpartum hemorrhage. So disclose clearly, involve outside experts. The family should not fear that there is a cover-up. This is not an answer. Some doctors had demanded gun power. But for violence, I always say, a problem occurs in my nursing home, there will be, against this Dr. Sanjay Saluja's case, which I referred earlier, why we went against Times of India was, there were 45 front page news items of more than 300 words each in this particular case over a particular span of a year or so. So I had made a complaint to Times of India and taken them to task on this issue. But the fact remains, we also have Fortis Hospital Mohali very near to us, and patients die there daily, and somehow we do not find any front page newspaper coverages from these corporate hospitals, or very few. Not as much as which occurs if there is a death in a small or medium healthcare establishment. So we need to learn from them. What is the first thing they do? They don't allow you to go to the patient. They keep you outside. You are allowed to go and see your patient only when they are ready to show the patient to you. You are not allowed to go in. And we need to learn from them. We need to regulate the entry of visitors. Good security, CCTV monitoring. Counselors, assistant managers, managers, general managers, as many tier as possible. Not ki suddenly somebody walks in, barges into my office, bangs open my door, Dr. Nagpal, ye kya hai? Mere darwaja kyun chu-chung kar raha? There has to be a tier underneath. But then, a small and medium healthcare establishment does not have the resources of corporate hospitals. So we are going to face those problems. A soothing environment. Be alert, evaluate each situation, be vigilant, do not isolate yourself in a potentially violent person or group. Try to keep an open path for exiting. Remove yourself from situation, call security for help, report any violent incidents which occur to your management, call for police help with permission. These are some of the indicators that patient's relative or the patient is going to become violent. Learn these things. Remain calm in the face of provocation. Try to know the SHO of your local area police station. We sometimes tend to think we are above all these things. We are not. It is good to know the SHO of your police station. When cornered in your office by 10 relatives, who in your establishment knows who is to call the police? Who should have already called the police? Who should have already called your friends? Is there a list of friends available with some any member of your staff who knows, yes, I have to do this in case a violent incident occurs? Is there a standard operating procedure for your hospital, nursing home or clinic? If not, develop it. Train your staff. Conduct mock drills. We say you have general managers, counselors, all these things, but ultimately who pays for all this? The patient pays. And most vulnerable are the bare stripped to bone small and medium healthcare establishments providing services in area of need. In area of need are the areas where Fortises will not come. They go to areas where they will have profits. There is also a non-reporting culture among doctors. Violence occurs. IMA ko phone jayega, Dr. Nagpal ko phone jayega. All of us will go meet the SSP. Matter will be sorted out to some extent. When we say that you have been attacked, you have been injured, why don't you pursue your matter? Invariably, there is a compromise of sort. Why did violence occur? Because somebody died. The person who died, his relatives have filed an FIR. You have filed an FIR. And in the compromise which follows, ultimately the doctor says, yeah, mera khada chhado, main theek hu aise. So what is the consequence of all this? Despite so many cases of violence, we do not have a single case of prosecution of the persons who have been conducting the violence. And why will they be prosecuted? Because the complainant doesn't want to prosecute. So ultimately somebody someday has to either die. That is my point again. Ultimately, how many doctors have to die for us to change our attitude? Do not hesitate to lodge an FIR, issue press statement, and press. Please be prepared. If you have an incident, prepare your press release immediately. Be prepared for calls on your mobile from 9 p.m. onwards. They will not call you throughout the day. Carefully note the name, phone number, email ID, fax number of the reporter. Calmly respond to his questions, preferably from your written statement which you have already prepared. Tell him to receive your fax, email immediately and send a press release. He should not have an opportunity to say he did not receive your version. Next day morning when you open the paper, still take a tablet of sorbitrate before you open it. Send rejoinder next day based on next day's newspaper report. Arrange for a rebuttal of allegations to be printed with view of local Indian Medical Association or your local professional bodies. PCPNDT, just 2 days before, this is Nadda Saab's statement in Rajya Sabha, under PCPNDT, 1,573 ultrasounds have so far been seen. 2,152 court cases have been filed by appropriate authorities against doctors, gynecologists, ultrasonologists. 306 arrests have been made for violations of PCPNDT. 50 cases of female feticide have actually been reported across the country. My question is, how do you win a war? You identify your enemy, prepare your army and resources, identify your enemy's weaknesses, prepare to exploit these weaknesses, attack your enemies at the weakest point, celebrate victory. What did we do? We identified ultrasonologists and gynecologists as our enemy. PCPNDT Act prepared to tackle the ultrasonologists and gynecologists. Their law-abiding and meek nature was identified as their weakness. Ultrasonologists were attacked mercilessly, crushed into submission, victory declared and celebrated. What was the enemy? The enemy was poor status of women. That was the enemy. Just last two slides, ma'am. What does MLAG propagate? I have not sent any representation on the PCP and DT Act amendments. I don't agree with any amendment which is being suggested in PCP and DT Act. This act has to be abolished. It has to be scrapped. Since this act has come into force, despite all these arrests, all these cases, do you know from 0 to 5 years, the female sex ratio has actually worsened? I am told today over here 130,000 women die every year from maternal mortality from maternal causes. Major cause, placenta previa, so many things which can be easily picked up by ultrasound. But we want to finish ultrasound and we want to control ultrasound. Let these 130,000 women die if they have to. Show that we have arrested some doctors and then get our echodales. But what are we saying? You give me 10 years, just one statement, one amendment in Hindu Succession Act, class 1 heirs. Remove all males from class 1 heirs. Anybody has to inherit a property, it will only go to women. No male should be allowed to inherit a property. If I, you may not agree, ma'am. I am here right now. Let me have the prerogative. I want to have a property in my name. Let me earn it. I will register it. I do not have a daughter, sister, mother, anybody in whose name my father's property can come. I have to adopt a daughter. I have included adopted daughter in the list of class 1 heirs. 10 years. Within 10 years, if this ratio does not reverse, I am guaranteeing it, there is no other way unless and until we lift the status of women in our society. You can have as many PCP and DT acts, you can name as many number of F forms, it is not going to make an iota of a difference. So before I am kicked off stage, keep take home messages, proper informed consent, prepare your medical records well, avoid overreaching, do not do things which you think are in patient's interest. Please listen to my words very carefully. Do only things which the patient has consented to. Aapko lagta hai ye kaam karne se main patient se consent nahi li magar ye main kar dungi, patient ka fayda hoga, kal ko dobara surgery nahi karni padegi, usko paise zyada nahi kharchne padenge. Let that patient or these issues go to hell. Save yourself first. Do only and only what you have got consent for. What is the only exception? Emergency, life-threatening situation where you're doing one particular action can save a person's life and you can document it and you can defend it in court. Otherwise, don't do anything in the interest of patient. Maintain good communication, maintain good security cover, good relations with colleagues, take appropriate indemnity insurance for hospital as well as. So what is the take-home message? Save the gynecologist, then save the mother, then save the baby. Medical Legal Action Group is a small group. We are around 330 odd doctors all over the country. We have filed many writ petitions in High Court. Some of our petitions are going on in Supreme Court. We make representations on various issues with Government of India. Dr. Archana is our very active member here. Thank you.
Sir, it was indeed an excellent presentation, and I am sure that all the members, all the doctors sitting in the house will go wiser from here as far as the medico-legal issues are concerned. We really appreciate you, sir, for this eye-opener and very, very interesting talk. Thank you very much. Any questions from the house? Yeah.
Thank you, sir, for such an informative talk. I want to ask one question. For how many years we are supposed to take the records? Handwritten records are must, or we can keep the records on our computers?
Electronic health records are